I'm going to speak five. Can I turn this mic back? Welcome to the meeting.
Oh, okay.
It's all right.
Well, if I wait any longer, it's going to get awkward. Okay, so welcome. This is all kind of new to me, as you might suggest, or no. So I have two announcements, but then I want to run a quick experiment, at least today, to see if anyone wants to add announcement to that, but it demands brevity. So after church, after coffee hour, there's a theology discussion group, probably 12:15-ish to 1:30. If anybody wants to join in on that, we'll sort of have a meditation and deal with deep thoughts and such things. And then tomorrow night at 7, I believe, there's a writing group that's hosted here. I got to figure out how to get it on Zoom too, which I'll be working on. And that's a group that's going to meet monthly, and it's sort of memoir themed, sort of a story. This one's about a pet. So if you want to come to church tomorrow night, we can we'll get started on that program. So I'm sure I'm missing things. What else is going on? I'll just pass the mic. Here we go.
To all the very devoted fans, the Solar Jazz Festival will be back on Saturday of Apple Fest, right here in the front, and they're going to be helping this year, trying to get. Hey. 21st this Saturday. We're up against it because everything is happening against Blake Street, and this aggravates Joy Jeannie so much. So all devoted fans, if you wish, please come and hear the red hot music for Cool Green what Technology. It starts at noon.
So this morning I was supposed to invite all of you to a gathering for Ginger Mayette was in town, but she had a medical issue and turned around and went back home to Colorado. So any of you that were planning to attend the gathering this afternoon, it is not happening.
On Wednesday, September 25th.
Yeah.
On Wednesday, September 25th. Oh, we're having an equinox ritual here in the church. It will be inside because we're all worried about mosquitoes.
The pagans are nervous about the insects. There's going to be trouble. Okay. Yeah, sure. The democracy.
As shown in the perspective, there is a care day this Friday afternoon from 1 to 3.
Care day. A care day is a day when you come and help clean up the church. Is that right? Outside. Oh, yeah. All right. That'll get less awkward as we move forward. Now,
our beautiful choir. Our chalice words are about water. Chris will light them. May we be as a community that moves like water, flexible, unresisting, without rough edges or harshness. May we move like water also, unstoppably, unceasingly, with time capable of carving the hardest stone, soft and flexible, persistent and powerful. Thanks, Chris. Perhaps for some of you, this is a true homecoming at the end of a busy, travel-filled summer. For others, to you, this summer remained close at home, true of every summer, true of every group. Regardless of how far any of us have traveled over the summers or whatever adventures you might have had, today is a homecoming in the sense that it's new to all of us, really. One of the reasons we use water for in-gathering ceremonies is that water is so much a part of summer's best moments when you think about them, right? You get those carefree summer by the water, by the lake. Everybody's got their stories. Probably you had some of those carefree summer moments. Probably you also had some of those challenges that don't adhere to any calendar addressment. You know, that's summer, that's life. Because it's precious and essential and nearly free and literally it sparkles, water is the great symbol for the start of something. It's also a perfect symbol for our capacity to forget what's important, isn't it? What we take for granted until we don't have it. When people are asked if they're to be left on a desert island with just food or water, nearly everyone picks food. When they're put on a treadmill for just 2 minutes and they're asked that question again, in short order, the selection switches. Today is sort of a tribute to water. I just gathered all the cool water things I could pull together. When we think about what people need, we often think about food and shelter, healthcare, we often don't immediately think about clean water. Statistically, though, across the globe, any group of people or a person that has access to clean drinking water is a more important metric of their future success than the education they receive. Having access to water practically also means having access to food, it being one of the limiting things to growing food. I'd like to begin our water communion with that empty symbol down there and the emerging challenges that water will present us as a globe if we don't prioritize what we need to prioritize. National Council of Churches have declared that the global water crisis is a spiritual duty for people of faith to reconcile. I think that's a good guideline to just keep water there as one of our issues that we need to be mindful of as people of morality and integrity and of faith. And in the way that Labor Day kind of calls us, right, to address worker inequalities, economic justice issues, human rights stuff, water communion calls us to the symbol of something we can all agree on that's not so theological, right? That's why it was invented for us, but the seriousness of water itself. So we think about the four directions. We honor water that comes from the east. It's symbolic of things that are new. Rising sun, fresh starts. Water is there in the south. It can fuel our ambitions and our efforts. Water from the west celebrates completion, and water from the north is cold and still, and it is kind of like Lent in the sense that it is renewing. So, water, important. Please join me standing in spirit, if not in body, and sing "Here We Have Gathered," hymn number 360 in your hymnal. Thanks for being here. Lavalier. It's not on, I don't think, right? Working on the details here. Sorry. There we go.
This is a prayer that I adapted from Mia Wright called What We Can Learn from Water. I think it's nice. Think of this prayer as a life lesson from our favorite. Freeze and close your eyes.
Find a nice still spot.
Freeze. Do not be afraid of rigid moments in this life, for we all harden. Sometimes there is not enough warmth to sustain us. But waters teach even rivers each winters to get still. Encased in the silence of icy immobility is a promise of something new. Just wait. You, like water, will thaw and live lush again. Just wait. Freeze. Flow. Gravity plays all of us. It's okay to go as you are pulled. Water shows us that flow is consent, not passive submission. Flow is the ultimate humility to feel what's real, what's right and necessary in any moment, and just be present there. Flow. You know it's no mistake that current means right now. And drip. Learn to meter yourself out as the cloud of your intuition advises. Drip. Learn to meter yourself out as the cloud of your intuition advises you. Decide what pieces of you belong where and for how long. Let your droplets kiss petals and light upon the earth in mist or heavy downpours. Do so according to both what this parched world needs and what you can freely give. Drip. And crash. Water says you're an intricate system of force, both feather light and ton after ton of pressure. In alignment with the moon, you shift the world. So when it's right and you are ready, the tides do on the world's shores. Also evaporate. Water gives us permission to leave whenever it is time. Never mourn. Tells us that the beams of condensation on your glass have other places to be, other purposes to serve, and so do you. So like water, sometimes evaporate. And flood. The world sometimes is just too much and we too much with it. Seasons will come in your life when excess is the only thing you have. You will well up with sorrow or love or fear until something is set. Flood. Not because you're weak, but because something enough is enough. Just flood until you're emptied. You will cleanse what is contaminated. It's all right. Water has those lessons. I now invite anyone who wishes to come forward, or we'll get the microphone to them somehow for Joy's concerns.
This whole Earth School thing has just been so hard lately. And like the song says, you know, there's so many joys and there's so many challenges. What I find is the pace of it, the cognitive pace of things and the emotional pace of things is just so intense. It was the end of 4 months of vacation. Please do not feel sorry for me. That's ridiculous to have 4 months of vacation. But then the start of school, I've already had one student confess to suicidal ideation. I believe I have a neighbor that I'm meeting with shortly that also. This stone goes to the 29-year-old mama who lost her life in a friggin' Route 3 racing accident. Her mother is a very dear friend of my mother's and mine. She leaves an 8-year-old daughter, and I will be going to her wake this afternoon. This goes for Preston and Lena, who lost their mama to cancer. She was diagnosed shortly after I was. She's been at it for the better part of 10 years. It's a good tribe, but we lose really good people. I've been mentoring Preston since he was a senior at Shrewsbury High to come to Boston Conservatory as a theater major. And he's so good and he's so loving. This is the start of his senior year. He hopes to begin classes tomorrow. The pace of it is all just so much. So, and then I have to end. My husband was miffed that I didn't offer Audrey and Les a blessing yesterday from him. And so I offer you this. It's 15 years already. What about your family planning?
So I'll make this brief because people keep asking me. Bob's voice has not returned, and we have no reason to think that it will or it won't. Hold him in your heart.
Hi, I'm Chris Woodcock, my wife, Corey. Is this on?
It is.
Yeah. It is. I guess it's a stone of joy for the passing of my daughter's dog, 15-year-old chocolate lab, the matriarch of the dog pack of our family, all the different dogs. Been around a long time since she was a puppy. And we're going to, you know, it's like all family pets, you know, when they go, we'll miss her dearly. But 15 years, boy, a long time for a chocolate lab. I'm also going to drop one other stone, another stone of joy that goes with the service today. This week, I was elected to be the chairman of the New England section of the American Water Works Association. That's the professional organization that encompasses all of the drinking water suppliers throughout New England. And I'm now chairman of the board of that board of directors. So.
I dropped a stone for Nancy LaPelle and Susan Folland, who are both struggling with Nancy's struggle with pancreatic cancer.
Hi, everyone. My name is Linda. I'm actually visiting from Auburn, California, where I've attended a UU church there for over 20 years. Sadly, I'm here where I grew up in Sudbury, Massachusetts. My sister lives in Southboro, and I'm here sadly because she just lost her husband of 40 years. He was a force. Carl Hanner was out on a bike ride in Western Massachusetts, which he did every day, and he suffered a fatal heart attack. So that's why I'm here. And I have to say, we do the same service, as you know, so it's really comforting to me. My sister's with other folks right now to kind of have that same ritual as normally I would be doing this back in Auburn. So thank you for having me. It means a lot.
Carl.
congrats for all the unmentioned thoughts in this room. That's for the people in the world suffering. Millions, billions. Mm-hmm. All the people who don't have a community like this to lean into. People trapped in uncomfortable situations and first and second and whatever world problems they have. Let's just be still with that for a minute. Amen. We're going to sing it, 'Tis a Gift to Be Simple, number 16. Remain seated for this centering hymn. That solemn, beautiful shaker hymn with a ridiculous collection story. Three recent college graduates, goes back in time a little bit, were celebrating from school a little and got on a hand drinking one night after all their ceremonial behavior. They woke up in jail only to find out they behaved so badly they were going to be executed in the morning. Not true. Joke. Silly. Super. The first one, a redheaded young lady from Ireland, was strapped in the electric chair, and they asked her if she had any last words. She says, "I just graduated from Trinity Bible College, and I believe in the almighty power of God to intervene on the behalf of the innocent." They threw the switch, and nothing happened. The prison crew all immediately fell to their knees and said a humble prayer, and they released her. The second one was a dark-haired woman, 30 years old. She was strapped in, and they asked her to give her last words. And she said, "I just graduated from Harvard Law School, and I believe that if I'm killed today, the law will eventually reveal the truth of my obvious innocence." They threw the switch, and again, nothing happened. Prison staff were stunned. Fearing sued, they released her. The last one was a young woman named Stephanie, who's our guide. Story goes back a while. She was strapped into the chair. She says, "Look, I have tons of smarts around electronics and computers and stuff." And she says, "I got to tell you, I just graduated with a degree. And if you don't plug that thing into the wall, no one's getting executed." So give generously. Thank you.
Don't give up. You're almost there. I'm going to read a few fun facts about water, and then we're going to hear from our choir. You guys are amazing, by the way, just so you know. So it's on the record. It's true. Here's a few fun facts about water preceding our water communion. Human brain, 2/3 water. So are trees. Water is, the water that's on Earth now is made up of the same minerals and elements that made up, that were on the planet while the dinosaurs were wandering around, which is super cool. A person can live without food for a few weeks, but a person can only live without water for a few days. Water is the only substance on Earth that transcends three states of physical quality: gas, liquid, solid. Water is so essential, so ubiquitous, that around the globe we now use the temperature that water freezes at, 32 degrees Fahrenheit or 0 Celsius, and what it boils at to set the standard for all temperature. When you think about it, water. Water is the primary reason we choose to live where we live. In fact, the first thing anthropologists or archaeologists look for to see where they will find ancient bones and ancestors, as well as animals, is where there might have been water. On a more ethereal level, water is perfect. It sparkles. It's pure. It's essential. It's valuable. It works without, it recycles itself without any of our work. We would do well to aspire that our character and our goodness be as freely given, freely flowing, transparent, and steady as water is. And it is a great symbol, of course, of the interdependent web of which we are a part. And now for our choir. Thank you. Wow. You guys are good. So I want to invite people forward, probably starting from the front, working our way back. I haven't fully orchestrated this. You can tell a tale from summer. You can pour water from your own tap or some journey you were on. You could talk about hopes for the year. You can really share what you want, but don't share too much. You know, I put some water here that you can just share, and this is our collection spot, and you can speak, and points for brevity. Sorry, somebody. All right, I'll start. I just flew over the Atlantic Ocean. And there's that.
You know, I took a deep dive into evolutionary biology and archaeology this summer, anthropology. And this is the source of water that the people used who made the flutes to survive. You're right. This is the first thing they would look for. And in a mile and a half glacier, it was always flowing.
This year, I went to Nova Scotia to visit my family. And Nova Scotia is a peninsula, and we live on this little section, which is also a peninsula, so there's plenty of water. My brother has a house next to a lake, and unfortunately, I dropped my phone, and my phone didn't recover. That's a not so good water story. And I went to Ferry Beach for a few days, and this is what I wore, so I'm so happy that purple was the color of the day.
Hi, I'm Lisa, and our water story this summer is over in Sterling at their wonderful town beach. Our daughter gets us a special permission to come let the old folks sit by the lake, and so we've had a lot of sparkling waters. But I want to share with you something about the flow of life in the in Utah. My son's mother-in-law is walking through the last days. And on the other side, my granddaughter is about to have a beautiful baby boy named Rocco. So life flows. Blessings.
Morning, I'm Tracy. The water that I brought today represents a beautiful time in Maine this summer with my husband Mike and our dog in Booth Bay Harbor, where I had an opportunity to go kayaking every day and found myself each time kayaking among a pod of dolphins.
Oh, wow.
And it was just a wonderful, beautiful experience.
I'm Donna. I don't remember if I got into the water this summer, but my son and his now wife, Leah, were married on the Cape on the 23rd of August. And it was beautiful weather and very generous of her family who live on the West Coast and their friends to come here for the wedding on the Cape. Tom and Leah live in Seattle now.
Rich and I went to Ogunquit, and I got to put my feet in the ocean, which I haven't done for a few years, so that was pretty nice. And this is not that water, because by mistake we threw it out.
I was reminded this morning by my faithful sidekick, Donna, that I didn't bring water. And then I realized I did bring water. And I always bring water everywhere I go. And it hit me instantaneously that I have never gotten up, despite the fact that we have a well, and worried if I would have water. And I resolved to add a few more things to that list.
Hi, everybody. So I was able to take a couple of trips to the Cape for Women's Week in Provincetown and Family Week in Provincetown, and was had the opportunity to begin a new program during Family Week supporting parents of kids who are in our collage programming, who, and collage is for LGBTQIA, who are parents who are LGBTQIA identifying. So so it's a way of supporting the parents, and in supporting the parents, we can help support the kids. So it was a huge success, and it was an absolute pleasure to be a part of. And I also had the opportunity to take Malcolm to Narragansett, which is where I grew up, and we went out to Block Island. And so it was a very water-filled summer, and I'm really happy to be back.
Hi, I'm Jeff. So we had quite a few water-related experiences this summer. We did a lot of hiking this summer. A few of our hiking trips involved water, mostly in the form of rain. we also had a nice trip to Indiana for a family reunion where we did swimming in Lake Michigan, and that was a lot of fun as well.
Hi. I spent time, I'm thinking of Donna, like around lakes, but not really in them this summer. But we spent time as a family in the Finger Lakes region of New York, which was really special for me as my kids grow and fly. And then up near Lake Ontario to be with the bigger extended family, which was awesome. And then I also was just thinking about being on the beautiful shore of Long Island Sound for an amazing mixed feeling celebration of life for a cousin of mine that we lost unexpectedly. So yeah, a range of experience this summer.
And to add to that, you know, on Easter, we went to the Old Stone Church, what choose a reservoir. And then a little later, we went upstate New York for our last visit to my mom's family's house that's been in the family since 1850, but it's just been sold. But we went up for the eclipse, and the day prior, we were on the shores of Lake Champlain and skipping rocks. Actually, we skipped rocks in both places. We skip rocks everywhere we go near the lake.
That wave of water was to commemorate my first experience with the Great Lakes. We visited my daughter Izzy's in Minneapolis and got to swim in Lake Superior, which created a bit of a stir in the community. People were like, did you see those swimmers out there? And we were like, yes, that was us. They were like, people don't swim apparently in Lake Superior. So we made our mark there and really loved just being there and being in that geology and that old, old water. I'm also making a shameless plug for, in addition to water, I think a lot about plastic, and I think about the interaction of plastic and water. And so we are doing, for the first time, a zero waste event in Northboro. It's going to be at Applefest. It'll be at the street fair. And this is kind of a culture change for us because we live in a disposable society. We live in a society that does not think about water, does not think about the preciousness and the energy that we put into clean water. So I would just like to make a plug for all of us to consider and continue our commitment to preserving water and preserving the ability of animals that live in the water to live without plastic in their system. So thank you and blessed be.
I'm Corey. This is pouring our water. I love water. Don't get me wrong. Water's delicious, beautiful. Water's my garden. Has kept my husband in business for decades. However, water has a tendency to seek its own route. And at our house out in the Berkshires, I have a very old extended family home that I'm maintaining, and I have some. I have the wonderful ability to do some work on it these days. I have gotten gutters put on the house. The rainwater is now going where I want it to, down the downspout and away from the house. I've never seen the basement so dry.
Okay, so I'll just read a few things, ever the PhD person here. So PFA chemicals come from manufacturing plants and aqueous firefighting foams and make their way into wastewater and outdoor air. From there, PFAS enter surface and groundwater systems and are ultimately transferred to drinking water, fish, and soil. Sewage sludge contaminated with PFAS also is used for fertilizer for agriculture, which is then used for human consumption. And so I'm just reading a little section about how plastic, microplastics get into water. And so I'm bringing this water because I do filter my water, all the water I drink. It's part of a process. I took a test and it showed how much PFAS I have in my body and how much BPA and other plastics I'd. And so having these plastic toxins, for me personally, the effect is I have high estrogen, or my body thinks I have high estrogen, but I don't actually have high estrogen. So it's throwing off my hormone balance. So I wanted to say every morning I wake up and I take water and I put it in the distiller, and every day we drink the whole thing, and it's a lot of water. It's a lot of process, a long process to filter water. And so I just wanted to be thankful that I had the ability to filter my water. I have the ability to change my hormones, and a lot of people in the world don't have that ability. And so we're continually being exposed to these hormones. So that was my whole story about water and how much work it takes to filter it.
I come from upstate New York, and this summer just recently did a trip through the Adirondacks with all the lakes to the St. Lawrence, and I grew up on Lake Ontario, and hallelujah.
Well, anyone who knows me knows my favorite thing to do in the world is swim. And we did get to do that a number of times this summer, but we didn't have a water bottle with us. But we have, in the last few years, started, rather than looking for amazing places to hike, we've done a deep dive into local hiking places, and it's been really wonderful. And I particularly like to make sure I see water on our hikes. So I went right up to that kind of muddy pond on one of our favorite places. And that's what this is.
So going into the wilderness, not much wilderness, but into nature is really important for us. And so I'd like to just quote something from Wendell Berry's piece of Wild Things. The last two lines are, I come into the presence of still water and feel above me the day-blind stars waiting with their light. For a time, I rest in the grace of the world and am free.
I'm Sally. I grew up in New Hampshire, and we had a cottage on Lake Winnipesaukee where we spent most of our summers. One of my siblings now has that cottage, and the other two have their own cottages. And we had a family reunion. I mean, I see them frequently, but it's been about 5 years since I've been to Lake Winnipesaukee, and we had a sibling and cousin reunion there 2 weeks ago, and it was just wonderful to be there.
Hi, I'm Lauren. Thank you all for welcoming us here today. And apologies for plastic, I was unprepared. So my wife and I just celebrated 40 years together and had a trip of a lifetime to the Paris Olympics and to Greece. So the water is symbolic of this, the Seine, the clean part of the Seine, and the Aegean Sea that we
I thought I forgot my water. I always have this with me. I'm Cindy. This symbolizes all the times that we've had grandchildren and friends around our pool this summer. We didn't do much traveling, but we did spend it around our pool. And I love watching in the first thing in the morning when the sun comes up over the pool, the way the water action in the pool reflects on our windows and our family room. It's just so pretty. And we'll be visiting frozen water when we go to Iceland in 2 weeks, so that'll be really cool.
So I didn't think to bring water, but symbolically I add water from the Sierra Nevada mountains that might not have been in there had I not come, so you're welcome. And just another note on water, it is my life's work as well as an environmental engineer focused on groundwater sustainability and groundwater remediation, and how, you know, it's so much easier to protect what goes into the ground. I mean, not put things that shouldn't go into the ground rather than try to get them out later. So And just one last note, the power of water, oh my goodness, it's so green here. I'm just soaking it in because this time of year in California, where I live in the foothills, it's just everything is kind of brown. And I love where I live, but I feel kind of torn whenever I come back here. So here's the water. It makes where you live so beautiful. And I'm just, like I said, soaking it in.
This is me being incredibly grateful for the water that falls on my garden.
Microphone.
I'm grateful for the water that falls on my vegetable garden. It's made me move every single day all summer and exercise, something I wouldn't probably normally do, and we get to eat the vegetables. So I'm just so thankful.
Well, I'm Linda, and mostly I've loved the rain. When I got up this morning,
the
deck was wet. So mostly thank you for the rain that's watered us most regularly this year than other years. We've had an awesome garden.
I'm Renee. I had the opportunity to go to Croatia earlier this spring. So this represents the water from the Aegean Sea and the beautiful coastlines there. And I got this water bottle there. I also filter my water at home. But of course, when you're traveling, you rely on buying bottled water. In Croatia, this bottle is all in a foreign language. You will notice that the cap is permanently attached. So it gets recycled along with the bottle. Why aren't we that smart in this country?
I'm Dick. I'd just like to thank the Reverend for this service today and for Olga for producing running water from the piano. Thank you.
Thank you. My husband and I celebrated 30 years of marriage this August. We traveled to England, Scotland, Wales, and we walked along Thames River a few times, and we lived, our hotel was there, so it was a beautiful trip. Thank you.
Oh, yeah. In?
Oh, hi. I wanted to share that I had an opportunity to take a dip in the oldest marble quarry in Vermont, which was wonderful. Thank you.
Okay. Closing hymn is number 414. Thank you for your stories about water. As we leave this friendly place, 414, standing in spirit, if not in body.
A collection of closing words. They're different ways of saying goodbye, which is essentially what closing words are. So let's start. Get lost. Scram. Please leave. It's time to go. Come on, move on. Something about how 3 days, old fish stink, something like that. You can't be missed if you don't leave. Time to flip the light switches. Honestly, come on. You don't need to go home, but you can't stay here. Arrivederci. Bye-bye, butterfly. See you later, alligator. See you soon, big bagoon. And a wild crocodile. They don't get it, do they?
They don't get it.
No. Come on.
Coffee hour next door.